Hi guys, I hope you all had heartwarming, safe holidays. I know I did. Had a really nice break, but I'm really excited to get back to filming. Today we're going to be talking about this serial killer couple named Fred and Rosemary West. They murdered at least 12 people, including some of their children. This story does include details about incest, rape, abuse of children, murder, and other terrible things these people have done. And before I get into it, I do post one of these videos every week, so if you like true crime, you should hit that subscribe button and that notification bell so you get notified every time I post. And with all that said, let's get right into the story. Fred Walter Stephen West was born on November 29th, 1941 in West Midlands in England. By the way, a few times I have said in the past Frank, accidentally. I don't know why I keep wanting to say Frank, but if I ever say Frank, just know I mean Fred. He was the oldest of six children born to Walter Stephen West and Daisy Hannah Hill. In 1946, the family moved to this farm, and the whole family contributed to upkeeping this farm however they could. Fred was especially favored by his mother because he was the first child of hers that survived infancy. Daisy's first newborn baby passed away shortly after being born, and consequently she never disciplined Fred as harsh as the other kids. Although she did have a rule that Fred was not allowed to have girlfriends until 21. When Fred was 8, his mother came into school to defend Fred for something he did. And because of this, he got the nickname of Mama's Boy and got bullied by his classmates. His brother John also was very abusive to him. Fred himself stated that abuse has always been a part of his life. He reported his dad taught him about sex with animals and that he was allegedly raping his daughters, normalizing that type of behavior. His father taught him the motto, "Do what you want, just don't get caught doing it." Despite all the cruel things his father did, Fred loved him and aspired to be like him. He dropped out of school at 15 and worked at the farm with his father. At 16, he started showing interest in girls. He began wearing cleaner clothes and combing his hair. He particularly, for some reason, enjoyed flirting with girls who already had boyfriends. And because of this, he often got into fights. When he was 17, he purchased a motorcycle and he had lots of fun driving his friends around for a few weeks until he accidentally hit a girl with his bike. The girl herself didn't sustain any serious injuries, but Fred was rushed to the hospital and went into a coma. He remained in a coma for a week, and when he woke up, he reported it was feeling like he came back from the dead. Turns out he fractured his skull and needed weeks of recovery. Additionally, he fractured his leg, and when he got out of the hospital, he was limping. His mother also noticed that he was less social and his personality was a little different. He was a little bit more closed off. When Fred was 19, he met a girl named Catherine Costello, nicknamed Rena. Rena herself had a troubled past. When she was 11, she attended juvenile court for stealing. Plus, she engaged in sex work as a child. Fred got Rena's attention by exaggerating his crash story. He told her that he died in the hospital and came back to life in the morgue. Shortly, they started dating, and Rena even tattooed Fred's name on her left arm. But they broke up a few months later because she couldn't pay rent and moved to Scotland. This same year, Fred, being the bold person that he was, he grabbed a random girl at a bar, and she hit him so hard that he fell headfirst onto concrete. He ended up back at the hospital, and this time his family noticed an even bigger change in his personality. He was really agitated and short-tempered. It was speculated that maybe his injury caused a chemical change in his brain. When Fred was 20, a 13-year-old girl named Kitty accused Fred of sexually assaulting her. This girl actually was speculated to be his younger sister, Kathleen, by some sources. Later on, it turned out that she was pregnant, and Fred told the police that he engaged in sexual relations with many girls, and he wasn't realizing the consequences of his actions. When he was waiting for his trial, his whole family turned away from him, and he left the farm and started working at a construction company. Shortly after being hired, though, he got arrested for stealing supplies and was ordered to pay a fine to the company. When it was time for his sexual assault trial, his doctor acted in self-defense and he told the jury that he sustained head trauma that was getting in the way of his decision-making process. The girl that Fred sexually assaulted, possibly his sister, refused to answer most questions during the trial and it was dismissed. Around this time, Fred reunited with his ex-girlfriend, Rena. After they started seeing each other again, she told him that she was pregnant with another man's child. This is when Fred told her that he learned how to perform abortions when he was overseas, which was a complete lie, although he still begged her to give it a try, and she let him. They found a secluded spot in the woods, and Fred brought an instrument he planned to use. It was some sort of 12-inch pipe with a corkscrew attached to it. Fortunately, they got caught before he got a chance to do anything, and later they got married. Fred's family thought he was marrying this girl because he got her pregnant, which he led them to believe. The couple again moved to Scotland, and their relationship slowly turned abusive thanks to Fred. He constantly demanded sex and even hit Rena when she refused. Rena herself would also hit Fred to the point of him dropping to the floor. At 19, Rena gave birth to a girl and named her Charmaine. The baby, as you can already imagine, looked nothing like Fred, and she got a darker complexion after her real father. And to this, Fred's family was in complete shock, and to make things sound better, they told him that they lost the first baby and they adopted this one. His family didn't really buy it. Later, Rena gave birth to another girl named Anna Marie, and this time it was Fred's biological daughter. And probably because of this, he strongly favored her. And Fred wasn't the best father. He built actual cages around their beds and locked them there periodically. The money situation was pretty difficult in the house, and to support the family, Rena became a sex worker and Fred was driving an ice cream truck. Even though he told Rena he was a drug dealer, when in reality he wasn't. Meanwhile, Fred was seeing multiple women throughout their marriage, and consequently Rena started doing the same and cheating on him. One day, Fred came home and saw her with another man named John. His initial response was to punch Rena in the face, and in response to this, John punched Fred, and Fred grabbed a knife and stabbed him in the stomach. No one pressed charges, so everybody moved on. From his affairs, Fred impregnated multiple women, and it's not likely that he actually claimed or cared for them. In July 1965, Rena met an 18-year-old woman named Isa at a local cafe. Isa just lost her job, and Rena decided to hire her to be a live-in nanny. She figured by having another person with them, Fred would restrain from being abusive. Through Isa, Rena also met a 16-year-old girl named Anne, whose boyfriend recently passed away at work by getting electrocuted. And while grieving about this, Anne spent a lot of time with the family and eventually also moved in. So, mind you, this family is living in a trailer, and now they have Fred, Rena, Anne, Anna Marie, they have Charmaine, and Isa. So they got a pretty crowded situation. In February 1966, while driving the ice cream truck, Fred accidentally hit and killed a boy. He was not charged with any crime, it was ruled to be an accident, but they moved to a different trailer park in Sandhurst to avoid backlash from the neighbors. There, Fred got a job as a truck driver for a slaughterhouse. The women had trouble finding jobs, and they occasionally babysat kids while getting paid in cigarettes and food. Having Isa and Anne around, Frank kind of didn't mind that. He continued to abuse Rena in front of them. And despite that, Anne was getting closer to Fred and even found him charming. In the spring of 1966, Rena reached a breaking point. She decided to escape Fred's household. That day, her and Isa packed her things and were about to flee, and Fred unfortunately came home early and quickly realized what was happening. After physically abusing Rena, he held on to his daughters and refused to let them go. Rena and Isa tried to talk Anne into coming with them, but she chose to stay and help Fred with his daughters. Anne was only 17 at the time, and Fred was 25. As you can assume, they shortly became lovers. When she turned 18, she became pregnant with his child. She begged Fred to divorce Rina and marry her instead, but Fred didn't want Rina finding out about their relationship. So after being away for a while in 1967, Rina decided that she missed her children and Fred, so she frequently began visiting Fred, and then she found out about their relationship. And at this point, the Child Protective Services were kind of keeping tabs on this family because they received tips about abuse happening in the family. And around this time, despite wanting to marry Fred and care for their future child, 18-year-old Anne went missing in 1968. We're gonna come back to what happened to her later in this video. This year, 27-year-old Fred moved the trailer to a town called Bishop's Cleeve and got a job at a local bakery. Around this time is when he met a 15-year-old girl named Rosemary Letts. She was born on 29th of November 1953 in Northam, Devon, to William Letts and Daisy Fuller after a very difficult pregnancy. She was the fifth of seven children born into a very poor family. Rose's mother suffered from depression and she was given shock therapy while pregnant. And some speculate that this might have caused parental injuries to her daughter. Rose herself grew up to be a moody teenager and she performed poorly at school. Rose's parents separated when she was a teenager. She lived with her mother and attended Cleve School for 6 months and later moved in with her father at the age of 16 in Bishop's Cleeve. There she met Fred. Her father, who suffered from paranoid schizophrenia, was prone to extreme violence and repeatedly sexually abused Rose and her older sister, Patricia. And he was just generally abusive to his family. For some reason, though, he was not as abusive to Rose as he was to her siblings. William was a Navy veteran and no one knew about his schizophrenia diagnosis until after he passed away. And because of his illness, he could not work and directed all of his anger towards his family in multiple ways. He regularly beat his wife and children except for Rose. When Rose was 12, she would walk around naked or almost naked around the house in the presence of her younger brother, Graham, who was 4 years younger than her. At the age of 13, on numerous occasions, she would climb into her 9-year-old brother's bed and molest him. She would do the same with her brother Gordon. Rose also sexually assaulted Graham when he was 12 years old. In 1969, 15-year-old Rose obtained a job at a local tea shop and was bringing some cake home every now and then to share with her family. One day she was waiting for a bus and was spotted by 28-year-old Fred. Fred claimed that at the time he was seeking help with his kids. He was looking for a nanny. At the bus stop, he charmed Rose and asked her out, which she declined. Over the next few days, he came by her work and kept asking her out until she agreed. He gave her gifts and charmed her until he invited her over, showing her all the items in his trailer that he likely stole. Rose liked Fred and his children, so she began visiting him quite frequently. Eventually, she would skip her shift at work and Fred would pay her to give money to her mother, which she was doing before. They also began a sexual relationship. Then she brought Fred to her house and her parents were shocked about his age. They completely forbid Rose from seeing him, but she somehow always kind of managed to escape and see him, no matter what. When her father found out, he beat her and lectured her. When that didn't work, they sent her to a home for troubled teenagers. There, her family rarely visited her, and she was feeling really lonely, and because of this, she again spoke to Fred. By the time she was released from that home, she was 16, and her family gave her an ultimatum. Either she would stop seeing Fred or they disown her. To this, she packed her bags and moved in with Fred and his daughters Charmaine and Anna Marie. When Rose was 16, her father made one last attempt to force Fred out of her life. He called social services and reported that Fred was having sexual relations with a minor. Upon examination, they actually discovered that Rose was pregnant. Not much came out of that occurrence and they left the couple alone. They struggled financially and Again, Fred suggested that Rose began sex work, and she did. Even while pregnant, she was working on the street under the name Mandy, which was also Rena's name when she was doing sex work. Shortly, Fred surprised Rose and their kids with a house that they would be renting. In order to make some extra cash, Fred stole tires and a license plate and made some money on the side. For this, he would get arrested 6 months later and would go to jail for 9 months. And during this time, to help Rose pay the rent, he connected her with Rena's past pimp, and she began working with him. Soon, Rose gave birth to a baby, and you can imagine it became even harder to pay the bills. Maybe it was this that got Rose abusing Charmaine and Anna Marie. She would tie them to furniture and beat them. In 1971, Rose broke Charmaine's collarbone and didn't take her to the hospital to get that taken care of. When she finally brought her to the hospital months later, it was for a different injury. Her left ankle looked like it had a stab wound. It's not clear why this didn't come out with any consequences for Rose, but I guess they got help for Charmaine and moved on. When Charmaine was 8, she was about to leave the house for school, but Rose had her stay for whatever reason. Charmaine went missing after that. Rose told Anna Marie that Rena came by and picked her up, and she never saw Charmaine again. Anna Marie would ask, why didn't my mom pick me up too? And Rose told her, well, why would she want you? When Fred came back from jail, Rose told him that she killed Charmaine. And he actually wasn't too distraught about this, since he never really loved her like his own. Years later, her body was found dismembered under their house. It was unclear how she was killed, but she was likely strangled. Over the next year, Fred and Rose grew closer, as Rose would bring her clients home and Fred would watch her from a different room while the clients didn't suspect anything. But what would really kill their buzz is when Rena, Charmaine's mother, would repeatedly contact them and ask, "Where's Charmaine? What happened to Charmaine?" This is when Fred met Rena at a bar, got her drunk, they had sex, and he killed her. He reported that he smashed her against the gate, and then he buried her in the field. When Rena was presumed to be dead, Fred and Rose got married on January 29th, 1972. He was 31 and she was 19. Around this time is when Rose got pregnant with her second child. They moved into a new house that would later be known as House of Horrors. Here's a picture of that house. It was a three-story home, and they rented out the top two floors and kept the bottom floor for themselves. And that helped them pay bills. Here, Fred eventually soundproofed the cellar where the couple brought Anna Marie, and they raped her and told her she should be grateful for the lessons they are giving her. Anna Marie reported hearing Rose laughing periodically through that. The couple raped and sexually assaulted Anna Marie a few more times that year. On June 1st, she gave birth to another baby girl and named her May. Since now the couple had even more responsibility, Rose decided to hire a 17-year-old nanny whose name was Caroline Owens. After living with the couple for a few months, Caroline moved out because she was tired of Rose constantly making sexual advances at her and Fred constantly lying for no reason. The couple decided to abduct her on December 6, 1972. They followed her for a while and picked her up when she needed a ride. In the car, Fred punched Caroline and knocked her out. When she woke up, she was tied and taken to their home. There, they raped her and eventually told her they were going to kill her. Caroline then begged them not to kill her and promised them she would be their babysitter again. To prove this, she kind of washed the kids and vacuumed. Caroline ran away when dropped off at a laundromat and notified the police. Around this time, Rose actually got pregnant again, and this helped the couple with the jury. All they received was a 25-pound fine. After I put it into dollars, today that would be worth a little over $200. That's all they received for abducting a girl and sexually assaulting her. Thanks to no consequences, they later did the same thing to their next nanny, a 19-year-old Linda Gaw. This time, they actually killed her, dismembering her body and burying her underneath the cellar. By 1977, Rose's father began seeing the couple more often, and they even opened a cafe together with Fred called The Green Lantern. It closed down pretty soon because they were not able to pay their dues. When Rose's father discovered she was working as a prostitute, he became her regular paying client. By 1983, Rose had given birth to 8 children, at least 3 of whom were conceived by clients. Fred willingly accepted these children as his own, and they told him that the reason their skin was darker than theirs is because their great-grandmother was black. In these years, about 7 victims became subjected to the couple's torture and rape and murder, and they were later buried under the cellar. And eventually, Fred actually told Rose that he murdered Anne, the 18-year-old girl that he got pregnant initially. He said he strangled her and buried her in the field. Fred reported that many of their victims were killed because they would become pregnant by Fred and threaten him to tell Rose, and because of that, he would murder them. Later, they poured concrete on the cellar ground and turned it into an additional bedroom for the kids. Eventually, Anna Marie ran away, so Fred focused his abuse on his other older kids. He had them watch porn with them and abuse them physically and sexually. Sometimes they would go to Rose and informed her of this, and she was like, okay, and? In 1986, one of their daughters, Heather, informed one of her friends in school about her father raping her, and the girl told her parents. Unfortunately, the parents didn't believe her. And for some reason, eventually, Fred and Rose became suspicious that Heather might be spreading this information, and Heather disappeared. They told the other kids that Heather ran away with a lesbian lover. But years later, they joked that if the kids misbehaved, they would end up under the cellar like Heather. In 1992, another one of the children named Lois informed her friend that her father raped her and videotaped it. Thankfully, that friend again informed her mother, which then informed the police. On August 6, 1992, the police searched the West home and discovered hundreds of tapes of homemade pornography, and they also questioned the children. The following day, these children were placed in foster homes. In 1994, the police dug up the West property and found the body of Heather and other girls. 50-year-old Fred West now confessed to his killings. This year, Fred was charged with murdering 12 women and Rose of murdering 10. Fred died in his jail cell at 53 by suicide. He left a note for Rose saying, "When you're ready, come to me, I will be waiting." Rose is in prison today serving her life sentence. Apparently, last year she was moved to a different prison in West Yorkshire because a serial killer named Joanna Dennehy threatened to kill her. According to Metro News source, she was gutted when she had to leave. She was in tears, and the prison officers just packed her things up. She was really upset. She didn't want to go. It's been her home for more than 10 years, and Wes is an elderly woman. And that concludes the story of Fred and Rosemary West and their terrible crimes. I'd love to hear what you guys think down below in the comments. I hope you enjoyed listening to my story, and I hope you guys have a great rest of your day. Stay safe. Bye.